All right, welcome everybody. Tonight is November 20th, 2024. This is the Upper Dublin School District Finance Committee, and I will call the meeting to order. We'll kick it right off with announcements. Any announcements tonight?
I do not have any announcements.
All right, thank you. We have our minutes from our October 16th meeting. Members of the committee have had a chance to review them. Any comments or questions on the minutes? Prepared to accept those?
Yes,
okay, thank you. We'll jump right into the reports and recommendations, starting with fire alarm system replacement services.
Yes, our capital plan has been calling for a scheduled replacement of the fire alarm systems at our schools. We've moved the schedule around slightly because we're finding out that our four elementary schools and the administration building, while the alarms are still good and functioning, the parts are becoming obsolete. They're no longer making new smoke detectors and pull stations for these systems. So we're really living on what stock is out there with the suppliers. So we're looking to replace the fire alarms at Fort Washington, Maple Glen, Thomas Fitzwater Administration Building. And then for Jarrettown was on the list, but we're going to hold off for this project because Jarrettown, while we're doing the study for renovations, while that work's going on, we don't want to put the money into Jarrettown if only it's going to be replaced shortly afterwards. So the recommendation is to replace the three elementary schools and all the parts that we take from Fort Washington and Thomas Fitzwater. They're the same exact system that we have at Jarrettown. Those parts can be used to keep the system running for many more years. So if we replace the three buildings administration, we'll have new systems there and all the components we need to keep Jarrettown going. So we reached out to ICS and Vervarelli Engineering for proposals. The lowest cost came in from ICS for $65,020 for the design services. This would be putting together all the bid documents for us, helping us evaluate the bids, go through any submittals and questions that arise during the project. Vervarelli came in for the same work for these schools at $77,000, so we're recommending to go with ICS for these services.
All right, thanks. Comments or questions from the committee? Is this a summer 2025 project?
This would be summer 2025, yes.
Anyone else? Anyone from the rest of the board? Itia.
Yeah, I'm just a little curious why this wasn't considered when Fort Washington was being renovated.
We didn't consider this. We had it on the long-range plan, but we didn't consider moving this up because this past summer is when we received notice that the parts were no longer being manufactured, and we should start looking into plans for replacement.
Anyone else?
Yes. And, I mean, the middle school is not on here for obvious reasons. It's brand new. But the high school, everything is...
The high school, yes, the high school, that system is the same age as the elementary schools, with the exception of Maple Glen. But it's a larger, Simplex makes that system, and the parts are still readily available. It's still a product that's in manufacturing, so we don't have any issues right now getting parts or to see any issues in the foreseeable future.
Thank you.
Anyone else? All right, so we'll move that ahead to the legislative.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you. We've got a project change order for the softball field.
Yes, and the one thing I will add on to that last conversation is, again, since we're looking to do this summer, it was important to bring it tonight, but at the December Finance Committee meeting, we will be giving our annual update on our five-year capital plan, so we'll give the committee and full board a full update on our capital plan, short and long term. So you'll see this on there. At that meeting, there will also be a discussion about, Mr. Lester referenced the work that ICS has been doing for us evaluating Jarrettown and what the what the evaluation of that building looks like. So that will all happen at the December Finance Committee meeting. So with the softball field project change order, this is something that was discussed last month. So ICS was here and gave a full update on the softball field and the work that the additional work that needed to be done there. They did give a full overview of it. So I'm happy to answer questions if anyone needs more information from last month. But last month, if you remember, we did not have an estimate on what the cost of that additional work would be. So we told ICS and Skepton to continue moving forward as the completion date on that project is important for the start of the softball season. So we have the change order tonight, and it's $13,558.19. So we'd look to move that forward.
Comments or questions?
Andy, I know we're keeping it moving, which is great. I noticed in the actual change order, it says extension is TBD. Do we get any sense whether Skepton's going to ask for more days, or do we think they're still going to be on schedule and the only thing that's going up is the price?
I'm not aware that they've asked for any time on this. So we still, our understanding is that everything is still on track to be completed on time.
Anyone else? Jenna?
So was this the item that was due to kind of the error in using kind of outdated, which, you know, in theory should have been, you should have been able to rely on them, but they turned out to be inaccurate. So what is this cost then being covered? Isn't that something we talked about last time?
So that ICS did present that they were going to cover that. We are still working with them on what that looks like. Yeah, so ultimately it's out, we hold the contract. So we do have to approve the change order, but yes, behind the scenes, I'm working with ICS on that.
Any other comments or questions? Okay, we'll move this one ahead.
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Insurance claim change order.
Yeah, so this goes all the way back to our insurance claim at Fort Washington Elementary School. So we, as I'm sure you were aware, we just finished up recently the bus canopy, and there was some sidewalk repairs that needed to happen out front of the building. So at this point, all of that work is completed. This is sort of the last remaining outstanding item on the insurance claim. So if you remember, again, we haven't done this in quite some time. The contracts are with the district, but Utica, who is our insurance provider, has been paying all of the construction-related contracts. So Utica has been in the loop on this all along. They've approved and are aware of these increased costs. So again, very similarly, the district, we would approve the change order. Utica will pay the cost directly to the contractor, and then that should be the last item that needs to be completed on our insurance project.
I'll answer questions. Right, and then do we have, are we formally closed out once this is done?
This would be the last outstanding item. Once this is paid, we would have a final reconciliation with Utica, but at this point, essentially, we're 99.9% done. The project itself is done. We just have some paperwork to do with Utica. Yep.
All right. Anyone else? All right. So we'll move this ahead.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Excess, obsolete, non-repairable equipment. Anything to call our attention to here?
I don't have anything, but happy to answer questions.
Anyone have any comments or questions on the two items in the obsoletes? All right, we'll move this ahead.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Monthly financial reports.
Yes, also not a ton to report here. We're going to go through quite a bit of financials with the two presentations that I have to provide tonight. So just note that everything is in order year to date. So total receipts are at 77% as compared to 79%. Expenses are 22% of the budget compared to 23% last year. So everything looks very much in line. Again, in the other financial reports, you can see, and I will talk more about it in our budget presentation, the assessed value update. So on the second page of our other financial reports, you see there's the listing of all the changes in assessed value year to date. You can see all of the changes on there from our annual appeals from commercial and residential properties. So again, I'll talk more about that, but it's all listed there, itemized, so you can see it. Property tax collections are trending slightly ahead of last year, so that's all looking good year to date. And then EIA, earned income tax collections and transfer tax collections are all trending very, very normally and in line with our budget year to date. So far year to date, everything looks good. But if there's any detailed questions, I'm happy to go through them.
Does anyone have any on either document? All right, so we'll move those ahead.
Yes,
thank you. And let's, anything fun in budgetary transfers?
Nothing to note. They're all just typical items at this point of the year.
Anyone have comments or questions? All right, we'll move those ahead.
Yes,
thank you. Final results from last year.
Okay, so tonight I have two presentations to go through with the committee. The first one, and we would typically do this at this point of the year, the first one is an overview of our, a high-level summary, I'll call it, of our results from last year. I hope what you'll hear tonight is no surprise. There have not been many changes from what we presented at the end of the year, and if you remember, our projection for the end of the year was about a $7.2 million surplus, and that's just about exactly where we're at as I walk you through this tonight. So I'll go through that. Our audit this year went very smoothly, so this presentation is sort of at the tail end of our audit. Thank you to Ms. Baldassano for, again, all of her hard work this year with our auditors. It was another smooth and efficient process. We are still working through kind of the final steps. We still have our single audit to finish, but at this point, we believe that everything we're sharing with you tonight, we don't expect any changes from this after this evening. So this is just a quick, a very high-level summary of where we closed the year. So you can see we're finalized with revenues of a little over $126 million. We had expenditures of about $114 million, which is about $935,000 below budget. And then we had capital reserve transfers, not the $7.2 million during the year, of $5,071,210. And that was made up of, again, since there's a couple items here, we had a $3 million budgeted transfer. We had a little over $2 million of transfer related to our insurance proceeds that we received back during the year. And then at the end of the year, in June, the board made a decision, the committee and ultimately the board made a decision to recommend $7.2 million, which was our estimated surplus, to be transferred to the capital reserve as of the end of the year. And again, the way that works mechanically is we approve a number, it gets included in our financial statements as part of our audit, and then we come back to this meeting with our final numbers and recommend if we're making any changes to that number. So if the additional capital reserve amount would be approved, our audited financial statements would show total expenditures of $114,069 plus the $5,071,000 of capital reserve transfer, and then the capital reserve transfer would have the $7.2 million added on top of it. So revenue detail, again, I'm not going to go through all of the details here. I just included in the presentation for reference sake, where we're at from a revenue standpoint is revenue exceeded the budget by $8.7 million or 7.4%. And again, basically every reason that we exceeded the budget has been discussed with the committee in the past. There were no major changes from what we talked about in the past in prior months. And they exceeded across the board in many ways. And this year in our budget, we updated things to get it to more realistic levels like EI, earned income tax. We made some pretty significant changes. Interest income was another reason. So interest, we were earning over 5%, and we have 3% in the budget. And then insurance proceeds was another big chunk of that. Again, an unknown item was about $2.7 million in insurance proceeds that came back to us that we transferred to the capital reserve. So revenue was very strong last year for a number of reasons, and a number of those reasons we closed that gap in the budget that we created for the 2024-25 year this year. And then on the expense side, again, very similarly, so this slide breaks down all of our pluses and minuses across the board. you can see that expenses exceeded the budget by $8.3 million. And again, it looks that way because in these numbers, I do have the $7.2 million. So again, there's a reason why I broke it out on that first slide versus here that's actually included in our numbers so you can see. And this was primarily the reason we're over budget is due to the capital reserve fund transfers being $9.2 million more than budget. Again, $2 million of that was insurance proceeds, $7.2 million of that is the recommended year-end surplus transfer. Personnel costs were approximately 2.7 under budget, and we talked about that for a number of reasons, right? So we budget for all positions, all contracts. Throughout the year, we have turnover, we have leaves that happen, so we generate savings through that process. And as wages are under budget, so are the benefit side of the ledger. So if we don't have positions filled at that point in time, we have benefits that are budgeted for that aren't utilized, and then payroll taxes like pension and Social Security, FICA costs end up being under budget as well. So again, all things we've talked about a number of different times. As we look at fund balance categories as we close out the year, and again, I'll reference this again in my budget presentation, but you can see that when we talk about fund balance here, we typically talk about the unassigned portion of the fund balance. So on this chart here, you can see there's multiple years of trend, and the blue piece of the bar is our unassigned portion of the fund balance. Just get to the slide here so I can see it. The unassigned portion of the fund balance is going to close the year at about a little over $9 million. Assigned would be assigned for specific purposes. So typically when we have assigned fund balance, and you can see in the 25-26 line and also in the four lines at the beginning, when we have to utilize fund balance to balance our budget, basically when we have a gap between revenues and expenses, that ends up being assigned to balance our budget. We have two committed fund balances that total $5.1 million. So one's for real estate assessment, one is for health stabilization. Real estate is $2.5 million, health stabilization is $2.6 million. We have restricted fund balances that are restricted and can only be used for specific purposes. Even the board doesn't have the ability to change those. So if you remember last year, we received a large generous scholarship of about $500,000. So that's one of the items that sits in restricted that can only be used for the purpose of the donation for the scholarship that it was given. And then we have special education compensatory ed agreements that have required special education costs in them, so we have to set that aside. And then non-spendable would be prepaid and inventory, and we have $242,176 there. So again, in total, our fund balance is a little over $15 million, but broken up into a couple different pieces. All right, so with all that said, again, looking back at last year, not so different than what we talked about in June, but as I reminded you, in June, we talked about this in detail. The Finance Committee and then the Board approved a transfer of the estimated amount of $7.2 million with the understanding that if we needed to make any adjustments, this would be the meeting we would come back to and talk to you about after our the conclusion of our audit. But tonight, again, it was like $7,219,000. The recommendation is to remain at $7.2 million, and that is what I'd be asking the board to confirm at the board meeting on Monday night. So again, while it's not my intent to finish the year with this large of a surplus, again, we've taken steps to close that in future years. We will continue to work through that. I do find it important to note that these funds that we're transferring, which again, we'll look at next month in the capital reserve, our five-year capital planning presentation. These funds are being set aside for a specific purpose. We have real projects that need to be done. We have $330 million worth of facilities that need to be maintained for our instructional purposes. So it is being set aside for real items. And then the other thing to mention is, again, savings generated now, right? The more we can pay for with cash that's earning interest saves the district and ultimately our taxpayers on interest that needs to be paid on borrowing of funds. So we don't have to borrow if we have cash available to do these projects. So I think that is a benefit all in all. So the recommendation tonight is to continue forward with the $7.2 million, or basically confirm that amount that we approved in June of last year. And then again, there is a memo included, right? There's a memo that sort of details a lot of this out as well. It's linked here to the presentation, but it's also attached in the agenda. So I'm happy to answer questions about the presentation or anything in the memo.
Any comments or questions on the year-end presentation? All right, looks great. Andy, thank you very much. And Jen? Let's move on to the transfer to capital reserve that you just alluded to.
Yep. So again, the recommendation remains $7.2 million, so this would just be the item to move forward for the legislative meeting on Monday night.
All right. Anyone want to comment on the recommendation to transfer $7.2 million to capital reserve? All right. We have discussed it multiple times in the past, so we'll move that ahead.
Yes.
Yes. All right. Thanks. We'll jump right into the preliminary budget.
All right, so moving along in our budget timeline, so typically this is the time of the year when we are talking about the first major decision that needs to be made in our budget process. So tonight what you're gonna hear is the second presentation of at least six presentations that the committee will receive on our budget process throughout the year. Last month, if you remember, we went through all of the budget assumptions that are used to develop our preliminary budget. We talked about those, we made some decisions, and those are what are built into what you will see tonight. Again, I think tonight is just a high-level overview. You know, I'll go through some details, but some slides are in here just for reference or for the reader, you know, that might pick this up and look at it as well. So some of these slides I'll move quickly through since we're at a very early point of the process. Okay, so most important here, again, when we talk about overview of the preliminary budget, we are in sort of the very preliminary stage of our budget development process, right? Last month we talked assumptions, this month we'll talk about how those assumptions look in the budget, and we will do lots of work over the next 6 to 7 months in order to get to a proposed final budget in May and then a final budget in June. Again, I want to reference for anyone new that might be listening, what we'll talk about tonight is not a final budget. There's no, we're not talking about setting a property tax rate tonight or anything like that. So that's not done or finalized until our final budget is approved. We'll talk about over the next couple months, and I'll get into the timeline here. So this is the timeline of what we walk through. So tonight we're talking about from the Finance Committee, we'll talk about the first major decision that needs to be made. And then at the legislative meeting, if the decision is to move forward with the opt-out resolution, and I'll talk about that, that would be moved forward for legislative approval. And then we would have December through February, March, we would start our detailed budget discussions internally. So we've already started having some discussions, but this is when we would do our detailed work. In March, we would talk about a revenue. I would give you a revenue presentation on the details of the revenue side of the budget. In April, we would go through details of the expense side of the budget. And then in May, we would propose final, and June would be the final. So that's kind of the timeline of how we'll walk through the budget process here. So to start, just a little bit about budget basics. Act 1 of 2006 is really what drives our budget discussions. So the budget establishes, Act 1 establishes a set timeline that boards and school districts must follow in the budget process. So there's two paths that the budget can take, and we've talked about this, but the two paths are essentially approve an opt-out resolution that says we're not going to raise taxes through our final budget beyond the Act 1 index, which is set at 4% this year, or approve a detail, approve moving forward with a detailed preliminary budget where we approve for exceptions that would be available to the board for exceeding the Act 1 index. And those exceptions are related to very specific areas. One is special education cost increases, which you'll see in the presentation tonight. We have some significant cost increases in that piece of our budget. And then PESRS is the state retirement system. We could apply for exceptions for PESRS as well. So those are the two decisions that we have to make. The recommendation tonight will be, and again, I'll get to this at the end, will be the opt-out resolution. I think the shape that the budget is in right now, I don't believe the board needs to consider a tax increase beyond the 4% Act 1 index. But again, I'll walk through some of the details so you understand the rationale there. Fund balance, again, we talk about fund balance and how it can be used, but I always think it's good to level set here the way I think about fund balance and why it's important. So fund balance is just very simply, it's equated to your savings account, right? It's assets minus liabilities is our savings account. And it's not sustainable to use your savings account to pay for recurring expenses. So when I think about fund balance, it's to be used for strategic purposes. And purposes like one-time expenses, if we're setting money aside, if we know it's a one-time, we can use it for that. But if we're using it for recurring expenses, then all we're doing is letting the gap between revenues, expenses, and get bigger, and eventually we're going to get to that point where it's been known as the fiscal cliff, and we want to avoid that as much as we can. So the other purposes of fund balance is for cash flow. So if you think about tax revenue doesn't really start flowing in until the August timeframe, so we need some monies available to get through the June and July timeframe until tax revenues start to come in. And then as you start to talk about borrowing, credit ratings are driven by available funding sources. And board does have board policy, policy 620, which sets the guidelines for our unassigned fund balance being at 5 to 8% of budgeted expenditures. And this is what we already talked about here. Again, we looked at this a little bit in the last presentation, but again, I'll note here, if you look at the early years of the 16-17 through 19-20, you can see, I want you to notice that gray bar, right? So in those years, that gray bar is much larger than any other years. And what that gray bar represents is the budget deficit that existed in those years. So we were assigning a good bit of money, millions of dollars, to close the budget gap during those years. And then you can see from 2021 through 24-25, we've been able to really have essentially balanced budgets during that time, structurally balanced budgets where revenues equal expenditures. This early look at the budget in 25-26, you can see that gray line, that gray bar comes back into place because we're using about $2.6 million right now to balance our budget. So expenses are exceeding revenues by about $2.6 million. So again, just something to keep in mind. We really want that gray bar in the budget process as we move towards the end to be as small as it possibly can. We don't really want to be utilizing fund balance to balance our budget in a perfect world. Property tax lingo, again, I won't go through a ton of this slide. This is just to note the difference and why it's important to know the difference between assessed value versus market value, right? We talk a lot in this room about assessed value. Assessed value is really the number that drives the property tax calculation. So you can see on here, it kind of walks through how you do that calculation. But again, it's important to delineate when you're thinking about it. What's assessed value? Why does that matter? We'll talk about assessed value impacts. Assessed value is ultimately what drives our property tax revenue. You divide it by 1,000 and multiply by the millage rate, and you get sort of our tax revenue. The other piece, important piece to note, and again, this gets to the assessment appeals, is implied market value. So implied market value is basically using assessed value to get to what the value of a home would be. And this is, I think, what a lot of commercial properties and residential properties are using to appeal their assessment. They're saying, hey, you take about three times the assessed value is the market value, implied market value of my property, and if it's more than what I think I could sell it for, then I might have a case to appeal. So that's what's driving this, because market values have gone up so significantly over the last the last 4 years, commercial properties really have not gone up that quickly. So that's what's driving the number of appeals we're seeing now. And then this is just a calculation of property taxes so you can see how it all works. Right now, our budget has a placeholder value at the Act 1 index of 4%, and you can see that, you know, how that all plays out as far as the calculation goes. So at a 4% increase, it would be about a $305 increase for the home at the median assessed value in the township. All right, so when we get into some of the details, this slide captures where we're at 25-26 budget, the preliminary version compared to last year. And you'll see here that we have total revenue of a little over $124 million, total expenditures of almost $127 million. So we do not currently have a structurally balanced budget, even with a 4% tax increase. Again, placeholder tax increase. So that requires $2.63 million. From unassigned fund balance to close that gap. And again, legally, we must have enough fund balance to balance our budget, but again, that's not a structurally balanced budget. And you can see that most of our revenue comes from local sources, 81% or so, and state revenues are about 19%, and federal and other is under 1%. So this slide is really for reference only. This is all the details of our revenue budget. Again, we will go through a full presentation on revenue, so I'm not gonna go through this, but it's there for a reference, and if anything jumps out and you wanna ask questions, certainly I would be happy to answer those at the end of the presentation. This is a historical view of our Act 1 index compared to district tax increases. So you can see in prior years, the preliminary budget was able to structurally balance the budget within the Act 1 increase. This is the kind of first year we've been at a point where we're not able to do that. So that's why we're starting from the Act 1 increase at this point in time. Whereas last year, if you remember, I think we were around 3.6% or so when the Act 1 index was over 5, because we had a structurally balanced budget at that point. This year we're starting from a deficit, so we're starting from the Act 1 index as our starting place. Okay, and then this is a look at assessed value trends. Again, I was referencing how assessed value really drives property tax dollars. So it's important to note that you can see the significant increases during the 21, 22 to 24, 25 years. And those increases were mainly driven by some new developments that we're all familiar with, Promenade, Madison Estate, and the Enclave. So we saw significant increases during that time. But if you look back prior to those years, we had a very small growth rate, and actually it was over 5 years, it was up slightly, but we did have some increases and decreases during that time. You can see here, as we're looking forward to next year, the preliminary look, we're showing a 1.2% decrease in assessed value, and that's mainly being driven by the assessment changes that we talked a little bit about last month. So last month, we talked about assessment changes that were not quite even at the levels we're looking at tonight here. So I believe, per the timeline for property owners to appeal their assessment, that we know, at least know of everything that is out there right now, right? So last month, the property owners and the Board of Assessment had until October 31st to make decisions. We're beyond that at this point. So I think we know what the worst case scenario is, and that's what's on this slide. Worst case scenario is a loss of about $28.7 million in assessed value, which equates to about $1.1 million in lost revenue. Some of this is already real, right? So if you look at Board of Assessment decisions, going back to our other financial reports, the Board of Assessment has actually already approved a number of reductions, not all the way to what the owner was asking for, but approved some pretty significant reductions. So what's already approved is $17.5 million in assessed value loss, which is about $670,000 of reductions. The owner can appeal that decision. And in many cases, I think we'll see appeals, and then that's where we get into the negotiation and settlement process that will go through. But we've already taken $670,000 off of our assessed valuation, off of our property tax revenues from those decisions. On the other, so what's built into the preliminary budget is the $28.7 million. On the other side of that, we do know that there is one new development. It's the apartments at 1125 Virginia Drive, which has my estimate based on a document that I received from the township a number of years ago. They do impact studies on new developments. Is about $28.5 million in new assessed value, which would equate to about $1.1 million in new revenue. We don't know if that's, you know, if that's a good number. That number is not fully known until the assessments until the assessments finalized by Montgomery County, but I feel like that's a good assessment. So instead of a new development driving new tax dollars, it's really just offsetting what we have the potential to lose as far as assessments go. So pretty significant impact. This is a view of the details of the expenditure side of our budget. Again, very similar to the revenue. I'm not going to go through all of these details here, but again, I'll just point out, you know, one of the big drivers of costs here is $4.8 million related to personnel costs. Personnel costs make up, you know, 3/4 or so of our budget. So that's a pretty significant impact on the expense side. But again, there will be many more presentations on the expense side of the budget. This is just what's driven out by our assumptions that we discussed last month. We also discussed this slide in last month's presentation, so I won't spend a ton of time here, but again, just to point out that if you look at our current collective bargaining agreements with UDEA, UDESPA, and then Act 93, our agreement with Act 93, we are looking at needing the equivalent of a 2.76% tax increase to pay for just the salary increases that come out of those agreements. So it's just important for us to keep that in the back of our mind as we're going through the budget process. PISA's chart I showed last month, again, this is more for reference. I won't go through this in detail, but you can see PISA's rates, employer rates are up around 35%. That means $35 out of every $100 in salaries we pay into the state pension system. That stays at that rate for about the next 10 years before we finally start to see some relief. And again, that's projected estimated relief based on a, you know, an unfunded liability. So, you know, we won't actually know that until we get to that point in time, but it stays at pretty significant levels. And then when you look at this chart, what this shows you is the state does provide all school districts with a reimbursement for the state retirement system, essentially their contribution. So we pay in, school districts pay in at that red line, the top line. The state, the gray line includes the state reimbursement that we get back at 50%. But what you can see here is that expenses grown from about $4 million to about $10.1 million actual cost for Upper Dublin over that time period. So pretty significant increase. The other area we're seeing significant increases is related to special education services, programs and services. And what this slide provides is a look at cost trends and then a look at the total number of students that are receiving special education services here. And what you can see is we've seen almost $9 million in increases over the last 10 years and about $6 million over just the last 4 years. So pretty significant increases. So while state funding for the special education has been increasing, our rate has really stayed flat from the state. And what that means to me, again, we don't see all these numbers because it's our number compared to everybody else's. But what that means to me is this is not unique to Upper Dublin. This is a statewide issue of the cost of special education growing because. While we've seen significant increases in costs, we've not seen significant increases in state subsidy coming back for those programs and services. Additionally, just again, without going into all the details, every year, every school district across the state has to submit a report to PDE. It's called Act 16. It's a special education funding report that we work very closely, Jen and myself, in collaboration with our special education leadership team to put together this report. We basically have to get down to a cost per every individual student that is receiving special education services across the district, and then report them in these category buckets here. So you can see that over the last 4 years, we've seen the number of students in the district with IEPs increase from 681 to 840, which is about a 23% increase as far as number of students. And then you can see how the impact based on the category levels are. So just thought it was interesting information to share so you can see what's, you know, what's driving some of those cost increases in the district. So we don't know a lot of things at this point in time, right? It's very early in our budget process. We're in, as I mentioned, the preliminary stages. These are sort of all the big things that we're going to keep working on. We haven't even started meeting with our departments and buildings to develop their detailed budget. But, you know, these are all the things that we pay attention to very closely. These are the big things that could drive our budget through the end of the year as we get to a final budget. So we'll talk about these as we talk more about budget presentations, but just so you have a sense of the big things from our standpoint. So I think in conclusion, again, I was hoping for a high-level summary. How do we make the decision on whether we move forward with an opt-out resolution or if we go with a preliminary budget and apply for exceptions to go beyond that? I still feel like while we have a deficit, we are still in a very stable financial position, right? So one of the things to note here is that we have a $2.6 million deficit, but we also have a $3 million planned transfer to the capital reserve in the budget, right? So if you factor that out, we technically are in a very stable position operationally, right? If you look at the operational expenses and revenues of the district, I believe that transfer is very important because, again, we've got capital projects. But, you know, if you just look at it from the surface, $2.6 million might seem like, wow, you know, that seems like a huge challenge. But, again, we need to balance that against the $3 million. I will also say that, though, we need to balance it against the fact that we have a placeholder 4% tax increase in the budget right now. So we get to this with 4%. If there are, you know, decisions as we move through the process that, you know, that needs to be lower than 4%, and again, that's the work that we will do throughout the year, every 1% that we take off of that is worth about $890,000, right? So if we would just take 1% off, we would add $890,000 to the deficit, and that would be the point we're at. So just things to keep in mind at this early point of the process while we work through this. But I think from that standpoint, I don't feel like the committee, the board needs to consider a tax increase beyond the Act 1 index. And my recommendation would be to move forward with the opt-out resolution for the legislative meeting on Monday night. So that's a quick summary. Here's just, again, resources that I keep in here. Again, as we move throughout the year, I'll add resources to this page, but that's where we're at in the budget process.
All right. Thanks for that presentation. So we've got two things to do. One is, are there any comments or questions on this presentation? And then after we get through that, we'll talk about whether we want to move forward with the opt-out resolution or not. So any comments or questions about the presentation first? Jeff.
Andy, thanks for all that. My questions are about the assessment numbers, just to make sure I'm understanding it. So I guess it's your slide 13 that I'm looking at. So first, on the new development side, do we have an idea or we're predicting that will come online in this budget year, or do we not really know that?
We don't know that. So that's just, I think that's a good clarification. This is not built into the budget in any way because we don't know when assessments will come through. It's based on the county assessor when they get to it, when it's ready to have an assessment. We also, you know, the developer could not finish the project, right? And then we would be left. So I tend to take a conservative approach and not include this in, but recognize it's there.
Right. So like in a best case scenario, that could offset, but there's no guarantee whatsoever that's going to happen.
That is correct.
Okay. And then on the other side, you've put into it the 17.5 AV already, potential exposure to 28-7. So that's sort of another unknown, or not unknown, but another gap that's not accounted for currently. Is that correct?
28.75 is what's built into this preliminary version. So yes, if, yeah, let's say nobody appeals the decision, then yes, we would be able to kind of pull that down to 17.5, and we would have a net positive of about $330,000 to the budget. Yes.
Right. Okay. And then, if appeals happen like that, do you get a sense or a flavor as to the timing? Meaning, does the appeal potentially shift it to a different budget year, or is it likely that the appeals come to fruition either by litigation or settlement in this budget year? Does that make sense?
It makes sense. And again, so if you look at the appeals, just the appeals that came through this year, so that were required to be submitted by the end of August, and the Board of Assessment had to make a decision by October 31st, all of those appeals don't take effect until July 1st, 2025, so next tax year. What sometimes happens is if they're appealed, they can take multiple years to actually work through, and then that builds up and becomes a multi-year. But no, every appeal that happens now will not take effect in this tax year. It will take effect in next tax year.
Gotcha.
In the year we're planning for.
Right. Yep. And when you say it builds up, because it essentially there can be a look back for the period during the appeal, right?
Correct. So if it would take 2 years to get through a settlement process, then we could owe, so if we don't, again, I don't want to overcomplicate this, but if we wouldn't settle this until after next year's budget is approved, then we could potentially owe back for a year, and then it would take effect for next year's. So there could be multiple years at issue. We don't owe any more or any less. It just becomes a timing issue of money owed back versus if it's settled now, it just becomes part of the tax bill next year.
Gotcha. Appreciate that. Didn't overcomplicate it. Explained it to me, so I appreciate that.
Any other comments or questions on the presentation? Okay. I just want to acknowledge and appreciate that you've included the $3 million transfer at this stage of the budget. That's not how we've done it in the past, and you know, I've been lobbying for that for a while. To build that in right from the beginning, even though, you know, the impact is, you know, makes it look a little bit painful. So with that, with those comments, our next decision is, do we want to recommend to the legislative meeting next week that we approve an opt-out resolution, or that we take option two? Anyone have a thoughts on that? Go ahead, Jenna.
And it just disconnected. So I'm in favor of the opt-out. I think we're already at, the Act 1 index is at 4%, and we're budgeting at 4%, but as we talked about, we do have some levers we could pull, like the planned capital reserve transfer, which, you know, we've spoken about before, maybe in light of the size of the transfer we just approved earlier in this meeting, or at least recommended for approval, we may decide to reduce anyway. So I feel comfortable enough that we have enough of a buffer. I'm not, you know, hugely in favor of going over the Act 1 index unless we had some kind of, you know, emergency that, you know, really warranted it. So I'm in favor of the opt-out.
Anyone else? I am also in favor of the opt-out resolution. I don't think we're going to need to exceed it, and it does... And I don't think there's cause to go through the more painful path. So with that, no more comments? Are we prepared to move that recommendation forward?
I mean, I can just say I agree with everything that you and Jenna said, so yeah.
Yes, all right. So you've got direction for that. Let's move on to the athletic director position.
Good evening, everyone. This is just a brief update on our athletic director. As I believe everybody is aware, that Mr. Hyland has submitted his resignation, and we are excited for him to certainly move on to his new position in another district, but certainly sad to see him go as well. Just as any time that a position is vacated, we reassess that position to determine if we continue to need that, if it should be restructured in any way. And tonight I will propose a restructuring of the athletic director position. We're presenting it in finance committee because I want to make sure that we are clear and that everybody understands what those financial implications may be. So first, let me start with what our transition plan is. We do have a plan in place. We have an interim director ready to go who would start on the 21st of this month and is available to continue throughout the remainder of this school year. Or until a replacement is found, whichever one comes first. We have about a week of overlap time with Mr. Hyland planned so that they can work through some transition items. And Mr. Hyland's last day would be on November 27th. We then hope to begin interviewing and starting that process throughout December and January with the goal, if we have a successful candidate, to bring that to the board at the January legislative meeting. And then assuming a 60-day hold, if they are at a current school district, a start date around March of 2025 for the remainder of the school year and moving into next year. So we feel pretty good about that plan. The board will see on the legislative agenda the recommendation for the interim director who we have certainly vetted and held an interview with, and as well as checked references. So our current structure of the athletic director position is a 10-month administrative position as part of our Act 93, our administrative group. They are primarily responsible for oversight of athletic programs in grades 9 through 12 here at the high school. Our middle school athletic programs are the responsibility of one of the house principals at Sandy Run currently. The recommended structure that I am proposing is to shift that position to be a 12-month administrative position, still part of Act 93, and then to assume responsibility and oversight for all athletic programs, grades 7 through 12. So some of the rationale that goes with that, when you are a 10-month employee, you work a shorter number of days in the year than a full 12-month employee. And the majority of those days are days that you don't work throughout the summer months. Summer happens to be one of the busiest times of year for an athletic director as they prepare for the fall sports, which is our largest season of about 500 athletes. When you think of football and some of those other sports, they actually are beginning to start early and earlier. Some of them start as early as the first week in August. Online registration, at least at the high school level, occurs all throughout the summer, and the AD is checking that daily to make sure that we're keeping up with those registrations. Other pieces, I believe this would create some increased coordination between the middle school and high school programs, things like consistency and efficiency with processes. For example, currently middle school athletes complete their registration paper pencil and turn in hard copy forms. And again, at the high school, we're using an online system to do that. Scheduling of different events, transportation, those types of things that can be coordinated across 7 to 12. I also feel it would create some strength in relationships between stakeholders, whether that happens to be middle school and high school coaches, whether it happens to be the AD and middle school coaches, it could be parents, and increase relationships with our students that the AD would get to know them already as seventh graders and then see them progress throughout the high school program. And also just an ability to advocate for athletics on a broader lens. Just as we look at level use facilities as an example, we look at that across all of our facilities or all of our grade levels, the same thing, looking at athletic programming across a full continuum and scope and sequence. And I really believe one of the largest pieces of the rationale is currently having the AD piece for middle school connected to a house principal are very two different skill sets and requirements for time. And allowing this separation will really allow the house principal to assume responsibilities of being an instructional leader and being available during the day when teachers or students are in the school building. So some of the supporting information, I won't go into all of the details, but we did do a comparison across Montgomery County. About 13 of the 21 districts in our county have 12-month athletic directors. Others vary. It really is unique and depends upon the size of the district, maybe the number of varsity sports that they have and so forth. So the position is not as clear-cut as maybe some other administrative positions, but again, more than half of the schools in the county do have a 12-month AD. Suburban One League, we also surveyed them to get an idea, and it really, again, again ranged, you know, between whether they were responsible for 7 to 12, 9 to 12, 10-month, or 12-month. There really doesn't seem to be a clear cut. It is very dependent upon the needs of each district. So the financial impact, I wrote here for 25-26, but I should have talked on that transition slide. We are not expecting that with an interim director that we will see any increase over what we already have budgeted when you consider the salary and benefits of the current AD versus what the per diem rate will be of an interim. We expect that we will stay within our budget, if not have some minimal savings there for 24-25. In 25-26, we would anticipate, if the board approves a 12-month position, about an $18,000 increase when you think about salary and benefits from what we are currently compensating. That's based upon the Montgomery County average and the surveys that have been conducted by the IU in terms of salaries, and then that's been prorated to be able to look at what a 12-month would be in each district. However, we believe when you think about what was budgeted in the 24-25 budget and you think about some other shifts of administrators that we have had into different positions, we have actually realized some savings in those particular shifts. For example, when somebody moves from one position to another on our Act 93 group, there may or may not have been a savings or a raise there that will compensate for that difference. So we actually expect no net increase to that piece when you think about, I believe it was two positions that we restructured, and we had some savings there, and then this increase of 18, they really should balance each other out and have a net zero to the budget. And certainly Mr. Lechman can answer that more if needed. So our recommendation is to shift the current 10-month position to a 12-month AD responsible for grades 7 to 12 athletic programming, and we would be requesting action, certainly if this group is willing to consider moving that forward at our November 25th legislative meeting. Questions?
Any questions or comments from the committee or the rest of the board? Jenna.
Yeah, so I do like the feature of having one AD that's responsible for all district athletics. That's, I don't know if that's typical what we have today, that you have a middle school administrator doing athletics. It always felt a little odd to me, but maybe that's typical. So I like that. That certainly sounds appealing. Can you elaborate a little bit more though on, you know, I don't know what portion of you know, the middle school house principal's time is spent on this, and can you elaborate a little bit more on what they're going to fill that time with?
Yeah, so I believe a significant portion of their job right now is spent on athletic director items at the middle school. A bulk of the summer is spent on all of those registrations that are coming in currently as a hard copy, scheduling all of the transportation, the fields, the schedules, when are we going to compete. So a lot of that work is done in the summer, and then that limits their ability to contribute to, for example, scheduling the 800 or so students into their courses or contributing to professional development, those types of things. During the school year, if you think about an AD, there are a lot of expectations for their time after the school day. That's when most athletics occur. And it certainly is not realistic to expect somebody to be in their school building at 7 a.m. when staff may be coming in and then be working every day to go to the football game until 7, 8 o'clock at night. So in order to compensate that, there is some flexing of their day, which currently means they may not be there during collaboration time every day. They are not there necessarily to see students off of the bus, and then at the end of the day, they are rushing to make sure the athletic programs are out the door and on their transportation. And again, those two ends of the day for instructional purposes and time to be with students are somewhat limited. So I do believe that will permit this person to have a greater ability to be an instructional leader in the building and interact with staff and students in a more educational way than in an athletic piece of that. Now, granted, somebody administrative in the building will still need to be a contact for the AD because they have to have somebody in the building that knows the logistics. So we'll still identify a house principal to be that contact, as well as their administrative assistant that is there at the middle school will remain there to assist with any athletic things that need to be distributed in the building or need to be created for the building.
Anyone else? Mary Beth.
I'm just curious in terms of physical presence, what those logistics would look like. Would they be housed at the high school and come over to the middle school as needed?
Yeah, I would anticipate that the AD will still have their primary physical location here in the high school where Mr. Hyland's office is now, and will probably spend a bulk of their time here. However, there would be an expectation that they'll be getting to the middle school, working with Mrs. Nusky and her team and interacting and have a space there that, you know, if they need to be there to meet with students or so forth, that they have an opportunity to be able to do that. So we would still expect that, but I would think that they would be housed mainly here at the high school. We do have already in our contracts and agreements game managers as well. Certainly a 7 to 12 AD is not going to get to every single event for every single sport. So we have game managers that, if needed, could attend and make sure that they're at the football game so that the AD, if there's, you know, something double scheduled or if they just can't make it. I also know from talking with Mrs. Nusky that it is her expectation that just as principals, you attend events. You know, you make sure you get to a couple football games, some of the other pieces. So her and her team would still be seen at those if, you know, certainly if the AD can't be there.
Anyone else? Okay, so are we, I guess, as a committee, prepared to recommend this for the legislative agenda? Thank you for that. And let's move on to an appreciated donation from the Upper Dublin Marching Band Parents Association.
Yes, very, very appreciated. And I'll note, Chris Horn was the one who coordinated this generous donation from our Upper Dublin Marching Band Parents Association to basically put the Upper Dublin Marching Cardinal logo wrap on the band trailer. If you remember, the band trailer was damaged back in the tornado. The trailer itself was replaced, but that piece of it was not able to be. So this is a nice, generous donation to get that back on there. While the donation is coming from the Marching Band Parents Association, Chris wanted to make sure it was known that it was possible due to donations provided by the Upper Dublin Marching Cardinals alumni and Lulu Country Club. So the total donation is $4,964.16. And is recommended for acceptance.
Comments or questions? All right, certainly appreciate the help from everybody who donated. It'll be great for the marching band to have their fully adorned trailer. Again, it does make a big difference in, you know, when you pull up to the event and your trailer looks grand compared to all the other trailers that are there at the same time. So we'll move that ahead. Yes. All right. Thank you. We are up to public participation. If anyone would like to address the committee, please come to the microphone, state your city of residence or affirm that you are a resident and your name, and you'll have 4 minutes.
Okay. Jenny Vitella Ambler, taxpayer. I love the idea of our AD becoming a 12-month position. It should have been. It should be. I hate the fact that they would be part of Sandy Run 2. It's a lot of responsibility. It's a lot of kids. And Matt Hyland goes to all these events after school. We have a million sports just among the high school. So he'll pop over to the field hockey game. He'll go to the soccer game. He'll go to the swim meet in the summer. He'll go to the basketball game. And Sandy Run has activities at the same time. I feel like at this point, I think he should, the position should be 12 months, but not take over middle school, maybe an assistant AD or an assistant, because it is 2 months in the summer doesn't make the difference for that, because there's a lot of stuff during the year that is after school, and there's multiple activities and a lot going on with the Upper Dublin High School. Anyway, that being said. So now you know that people talk to me. So this, I'm reporting to you questions that people ask me for the following items. What is our lice policy? There are parents that are noticing that kids in their children's classroom or hearing have live lice bugs in their hair and they're not being sent home. Back in the day, that was a policy that kids that had live lice in their hair would send home because it spreads very easily, lice does, through coats, clothing, just brushing next to somebody, especially in elementary school, which is where there's a problem, and it can be very costly to eliminate. So there are people that might not be able to afford to get that removed, and many are being exposed if there's kids in school with live lice. So I'm wondering if there has been a change in the policy. Also, There's a community concern. Apparently, there's some issues with kids getting sick at Fort Washington, like the air quality, like something with humidity or temperature or mold. I don't really know. All I know is people have said that there's problems with the air and kids are getting sick. So I just wanted to know if you've heard about that, if there's anything being done about that, has it looked into? Also, can you remind us what the district policy in terms of class sizes at elementary school? It has been noted that Fort Washington has increased their student population by 21 kids. Jarrettown actually is down 12. Thomas Fitz is up 12. Maple Glen is even. And Fort Washington has three, and I forgot my paper. I printed it out and everything, and I forgot it. But Fort Washington has three of the largest grade levels in the district. Jarrettown has one. So I think Fort Washington, if memory serves, has second, third, and fifth, and Jarrettown had fourth, like over 90 some. So the classrooms are getting 24 plus kids, and there is some concern along those lines. So I just want to know what the district policy on that, and if we're watching that in terms of adding more staff. Those new curbs that we just paid for at Fort Washington Elementary School, I have also been reported that there's already buses scraping them, and they're getting scraped up. My question, besides the athletic director, my question is, I thought the landscaping project for Fort Washington had something to do with the insurance from the tornado, but you mentioned earlier today that that project's almost over, so I was just a little curious if you could clarify what the difference is between the project being almost complete and the landscape project that's, I thought, was part of that. Okay, thank you.
Anita Brister, Fort Washington. I have some questions first about additional administrative positions, if you could verify. I think there are four new additional positions, the assistant superintendent, a communications director, a data administrator, I believe it's Mr. Ortiz, I don't know the official title, and a social worker. So could you verify that there are four additional administrative positions, or if I'm wrong and there's more or less, please correct me. I'd like to know in general, looking at, I'm not asking about what the new people are actually making right now, but I'd like to know if in general, in the Act 93 group, did the Act 93 group get 3% last year, a 3% increase last year? I'm not asking about the superintendent right now, I'm just asking about the Act 93. Can you tell me what's built into this budget for the Act 93 group administrators? Is 3% built into this budget? I want to say a couple words about there's a meeting Monday. You're having a meeting Monday, but there's a meeting for those of us interested in talking about the zoning. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to hit every note here that I want to say, but I will say a couple. One of the things I value, and I don't know how many of you remember this, but one time a very sweet parent and her child came to speak at these meetings to talk about the value of the outdoor space at his elementary school. That was Fort Washington Elementary School. And I do think that's one of the biggest values that we're lucky to have, not just us, but most suburban districts. And I don't love the idea of putting all those vehicles and buses so close to a playground or even so close to that building. So I think you're ignoring the value of the outdoor spaces of your own property, but it's, when I say your own property, honestly, it's our own property. We pay for it. All the taxpayers pay for it. Safety, a gentleman stood up here a few months ago and said, this is an accident waiting to happen. Well, now in the past few months, we've seen accidents. We can't say, I'm not saying that they were caused by school buses, but caused by, it's a very busy intersection, okay? And to add more traffic and buses to a very busy intersection certainly could be an accident waiting to happen. I'm very disturbed by something that the lawyer for this, the special lawyer, I'll call him, and quite honestly, I don't know his name. I'll try to find that out next Monday at the zoning meeting. the special lawyer, I'm going to call him, that's representing you, the district. So he's certainly representing the school board because you hired him. He's quoted in an article you can get to, it's a reporter online, but it's a few weeks old now. He didn't say this at the meeting, to my knowledge, because I was at the meeting and I didn't hear it at the meeting. But to the reporter, the attorney for the district said, it's a fantastic location. Okay, for the sake of time, I'll just say this. It is surrounded by all neighborhoods that are zoned A residential. If it was a fantastic location to put a bus garage there, it would be a commercially zoned area. Okay, it is not fantastic based on just the size, the huge size of the building violates one variance. The sheer weight of all those vehicles violates another variance. And there's basically four variances that it violates. So your attorney, who represents you, so you must agree with it, thinks it's a fantastic location.
Okay, seeing no one else come up to the mic, we'll close public participation. There were no comments submitted through the online form. I will quickly cover, there was a comment about, or a question really, about whether the landscape project was covered by insurance, or clarification wanted on that. So the idea is we had an insurance surplus. So we got extra money back from the insurance company that we haven't yet spent on repairs. And so the proposal was to use some of that surplus to pay for the tree canopy project or landscaping project. So unlike the rest of the insurance project where we held the contract but the insurance company paid for it directly, that's not what's happening with this one. This is our decision to use some of that insurance surplus on a landscaping project. So I hope that clarifies that. So the insurance, we already have that money. That money has already been delivered to us, and that so the insurance project for Fort Washington can be closed out. There were some questions that are really questions for, not for the board, but for the principal or the nurse. I would advise going there for anyone who has that question. And of course, we do have a document that explains our usual or proper process to get your questions to the right people. We can make sure that gets shared out in future communications again. Any other comments from the administration? Lori?
I appreciate Mr. Sirota referencing our communication pathways. I do. There were two policy questions that I guess I'll try, or I think at least one of them. Class size policy is policy 126. There's an administrative regulation. It is not set numbers in stone. They are guidelines. K to 2 is 22 and 3 to 5 is 24. We absolutely look at those as we're planning for the school year and certainly monitor them once the year has started. It's much harder to change staffing once the year has started if you have that because it impacts lots of students. However, we absolutely do look at that. I also want to say, at least to my knowledge, not aware of sick children at Fort Washington that would have anything to do with air quality. We do check air quality periodically or if there is a concern, and I'll certainly follow up with Mr. McAleer to see, but have heard nothing of that manner. And to clarify, there were not four administrative positions added into this budget. There were two, an assistant superintendent and a director of communications. The Director of Data and Strategic Partnerships was a replacement of the Chief Academic Officer position and a financial savings in terms of salary, and the social worker is part of UDEA, the collective bargaining piece. And I believe the salaries associated are part of board agendas, and what's included in the budget was part of the presentation this evening. Thank you.
All right. Any other comments from, yeah, Jeff?
There was a reference to our meeting on Monday night. I just wanted to make sure everyone knew that our legislative meeting on Monday night is going to start at 6 o'clock as referenced on the school district calendar. We're usually at 7 for legislative, 6 o'clock this month.
All right, thank you. So that brings us to the end of our agenda, which I am pulling up again. To make sure I cover everything. Our next Finance Committee meeting will be Wednesday, December 11th at 6 p.m. here in the Cardinal Room. As Mr. Wallach already noted, our legislative meeting next month will start an hour early, an hour earlier than usual. Next week, we'll start an hour earlier. And with that, we are adjourned. Thank you all.